Whenever I get gloomy with the state of the world, I think about the arrivals gate at Athens Airport. General opinion starting to make out that we live in a world of hatred and greed. But I don't see that. It seems to me that Eurovision, actually, is all around. Hello, and welcome to Overthinking Eurovision. I'm Matt Rather. If you're a national broadcaster picking a Eurovision entry, you have three options. Option one, choose something that you think is going to have broad appeal all over Europe. Option two, choose something completely out of left field to stand out from the crowd.
Let me taste the lows and highs. Let me feel that burning fright.
Option two can be high risk, high reward. Sometimes you wind up with a who the hell is Edgar, but sometimes you get a still in love with you. Option three, pick something that truly represents your country. For instance, select a popular local artist and have them sing in your native language. Sometimes you want to go super traditional, showing off your folk music, dance, and costumes. But you can also do a modern spin on something traditional. The key thing about option three is that the national broadcaster is trying to say, this is us. This is who we are as a nation. But what if a broadcaster presents a vision of the nation a big chunk of that nation doesn't like? On March 20th, the Greek magazine Lifo published an article about the mixed reaction to Marina Sati's Eurovision song. The subtitle read, "Can we bear to see our face in the mirror? We saw for a moment, with horror, how others see us. We saw a look that was hard to shake off, the quaintness overflowing, and the pillars of the country's tourism industry resting on exactly what we tend to think of as clichés." Marina Sati is the daughter of a Greek mother and a Sudanese Arab father. Her early musical tastes weren't Greek. She was into Bjork, German electronic music, and classical piano. For a while, she wanted to be an actress, and she studied architecture in college. But then she got a scholarship to the Berklee School of Music in the United States. And ironically, it was while she was studying abroad that she finally connected with the Greek and Arabic music she had grown up with.
There, I started being more like myself, and it's very interesting because you realize that the further you go sometimes from your house, from your safe space where you grew up, the closer you can get to who you really are.
In 2016, Marina released a single to YouTube, Kupes, which means cups in English. Cups is not a Greek version of that Anna Kendrick song from Pitch Perfect. It was a cover of a Greek song from 1928. That original version of Kupes was in a style known as rebetiko. This was a form of urban popular music that mashed up traditional Greek music with influences from all over Europe, the Ottoman Empire, and even Greek Orthodox church music. It's not surprising that rebetiko music appealed to Marina, because she described her own style as blender music, mixing together everything she loved.
Εντάξει, όλα τα χρόνια της ζωής μου άκουα pop μουσική, προφανώς και hip-hop και rap και rock σε άλλες φάσεις. Προσπαθώ και σε τραγούδια που φτιάχνω και που γράφω να συνδυάζω αυτά τα στοιχεία που με έχουν επηρεάσει μέσα στη ζωή μου και όλους τους ήχους.
So you might say she was a neo-rebetiko artist picking up a 100-year-old rebetiko classic, and it was a social media sensation. The original track has over 27 million views, and there are remixes that have millions of views themselves. But that was just a cover song. For Marina to take the next step on her journey, she was going to need a little Disney magic. Producer Matt Belinky has three children, and he feels like people are not talking enough about how Marina did the Greek dub of Moana, which makes her an actual Disney princess. And it was actually her co-star, Mihalis Kouinelis, who wrote the lyrics for what would be Marina's first original song.
Παιδιά, μου έφερε αυτό το στίχο και με τη μία έπιασε και αυτό το vibe, έτσι το λίγο πιο μυσταγωγικό μυστήριο με την έννοια της Μάντης, ας πούμε.
Madisa was a sensation, with over 56 million views on YouTube. To put that in perspective, the entire population of Greece is around 10 million. And a big part of the appeal is that the song offered a sense of optimism and resilience to a generation that had been devastated by the 2008 economic crash. As for Mihalis Kouinelis, who provided the lyrics,
what can he say except Karamu?
There are two things about the Majisa music video that seem relevant to Eurovision 2024. First, the whole thing was filmed in one long take. That immediately caught our attention because on March 16th, it was reported that Marina planned to capture her Eurovision performance the same way. One camera, no cuts. So this is an artistic idea that she has been toying with since the very beginning of her career. Secondly, the video was shot on the post-financial crisis streets of Athens and shows a side of urban life that's far from the picture of classical Greece that we have in our heads. And this may be the single biggest theme in Marina's entire body of work. Here's an interview from 2022 that sums up her whole philosophy.
Greece is not only statues.
What is Greece exactly? Except statues.
This!
To Marina, Greece is more than the ancient past. Greece is the streets. And she is passionate about sharing that with her international fans.
They know about Mykonos, they know about the Acropolis and the ancient times, but not so much about the culture that is going on right now. It's interesting to share these images and these sounds with the people, and I feel it connects. It makes us connect.
After Mantisa, Marisa took a few years to make her first album, Yena. It was a further evolution of her blender style, mixing traditional sounds and world music. From an interview around this time, she said one of her biggest musical inspirations was M.I.A., a British rapper who incorporates so-called world music into her sound. Another one of Marina's big influences is the Spanish singer Rosalía. Her 2018 album, El Mal Querer, was inspired by a 13th century novel, and every track represented a different chapter of the book. It mashed up pop, hip-hop, and flamenco, and it won a Latin Grammy Award for Album of the Year. The album also served as Rosalía's college graduation project, and I'm gonna assume that she got an A. Anyway, Marina's Yena album seems to have a lot in common with Rosalía. Now, as you can tell, Marina had a bigger budget for her Yena music videos, and they often included interesting juxtapositions between the traditional and the modern. One of the images she keeps coming back to is the donut. No, not that kind. Her music video for the song Miroloi ends with a 50-second shot of a traditional Greek dancer being circled by a car doing donuts. There's the suggestion here that the car is the modernized version of the dancer, a contemporary expression of the same joyous spirit. In the video for Polly, you can see Marina doing donuts while sticking her head out the window. But another thing to notice about this Miroloi clip is that it is very anxiety-inducing. The dancer is one step away from getting flattened by a Skoda. Now take a look at yet another video with the donuts, this one from 2023. There's that same nonchalance in the face of extreme danger. And I think that this hints at a darker meaning. The donuts represent a world that's spinning out of control, inches away from catastrophe. This generation of young Greeks have lived through that for half their lives now. Marina's determination not only to face the donuts without fear, but to look good doing it, is quite the statement. And it's no wonder that she keeps coming back to this image. By the way, this song is called Spirto Ke Venzini, and a repeated line is, "Throw a match on my body to set me on fire." This is a love song, believe it or not, and the lyric is a reference to a popular 1992 song by Katerina Kouka. At a Greek music award show in 2023, Marina and Katerina performed both the songs together. This was sort of a passing of the torch, a demonstration that Marina's music is modern pop, but with roots in the working class music of the past. And perhaps this is what convinced the Greek broadcaster ERT that she was the woman they needed. On October 24th, 2023, Marina was announced as the Greek representative for Eurovision. But they also announced something surprising. They had no idea what she would be singing. The press release actually included an email address for people to send in songs that Marina might like, and they received over 200 submissions. Contrast this with the French artist Slimane, who said that he wouldn't accept a Eurovision invitation until he had the perfect song ready to go.
And when Mon Amour, which is the title of the song, arrived, then it was clear for me. I know that I was ready and I said, let's go.
At first, this open call for song submissions feels very strange. Marina is a singer-songwriter. Why would you pick her for Eurovision if you weren't going to have her write you a song? But remember that Marina has always thought of herself as a blender artist, At times, she sounds more like a museum curator of interesting musical ideas than as someone who creates songs in a vacuum.
So for me, like this synthesis and taking like many pieces, like to tell a story and to create something bigger out of smaller pieces, and yeah, is something that I love to do.
In an interview with Glance, a Greek lifestyle website, she explained, "Together with my partners, the company, and ERT, we chose the elements and pieces that we liked. Zari resulted from a combination of musical compositions and lyrics." And she was not kidding. Take a look at the massive list of songwriters and producers that are credited on this Franken song. Hey, leave a comment below if you did not work on this song. But before you do, you might want to double check this list just in case. Interestingly, the lyrics were actually one of the last pieces to fall into place.
Ούτε στίχη, τίποτα. Ήταν κάτι λαλαλά και κάτι ακόρδα.
Οπότε το ζάρι δεν έχει να κάνει με το στίχο μέσα.
You might expect that with so many cooks in the kitchen, there wasn't much for Marina to do. But she actually seems to have been very hands-on in pulling things together.
She broke down all of her ideas around the song and what it should sound like, what it should feel like.
On an Instagram live stream, she showed off some of the vocal layering, and she seemed completely comfortable putting together a mix by herself, which is certainly not true of all singers. Musically, she had one main goal: to take traditional Greek elements and use them to make something fresh.
So, ένα ωραίο project που να είναι σύγχρονο, να αντιπροσωπεύει, ας πούμε, τη γενιά μου στην Ελλάδα. Τη νέα Ελλάδα και όχι, ας πούμε, ίσως αυτά τα, την εικόνα που μπορεί να έχουν και οι ξένοι για μας με αυτά τα στερεότυπα, το ζορμπά, το σιρτάκι, το σαχανάκι.
As you might expect from a song that started out as a bunch of songs, Zari combines even more styles than most Marina songs. The singing style at the beginning is known as Amanes, and it's from Asia Minor, which is part of modern-day Turkey. There's Greek instruments in there, but also a lot of Balkan influence. Oh, you want some rap? Sure, why not? A lot of people online felt that the beat was reggaeton, but Marina pointed out that Greece actually has its own musical tradition that uses the same rhythm. This is something that she's emphasized for years, that musical styles from opposite sides of the world can have more in common than you'd expect.
And this dance is actually called sirtos. So the reggaeton for you guys outside of Greece, in Greece we call it sirtos.
Still, the fact that Marina had to jump on Instagram Live to clap back might clue you in that not everyone loved this song. Some people felt that the Balkan and Eastern influences were inappropriate for a song representing Greece. But Marina has argued that Greek music shouldn't be constrained by present-day political borders.
The history of the culture and the civilization and the music and the arts is much older than the borders of the nations and of the countries. For me, you're like is brother vibes, for
brother
sure.
Vibes. This makes her a poster child for the Eurovision mindset, by the way. She's a proud Greek, but she's also globalist and multicultural. The mix of styles is probably exactly what the Greek broadcaster was expecting when Marina was picked. And while it struck some as a chaotic debasement of the country's musical traditions, that wasn't even the main thing that made the song divisive. It was the way the country was depicted in the music video that a lot of Greeks found shocking and disrespectful, and specifically, the way Zari depicts Greece's most important industry. Eurovision and tourism have always been closely linked. Winning the contest not only means your country gets to host tens of thousands of people the next year, it also means you get to produce what is in effect a 3-hour-long commercial for visiting your country. The last time Greece hosted Eurovision was 2006. Here are some of the postcards from that year. They're a stunning parade of beautiful beaches, mouth-watering food, and marble statues. They're also a fantasy. To make a Greek joke, these cards are the platonic ideal of Greek tourism. Hold for laughter. And it's not like Greece is unique here. Any nation is going to depict itself in the best possible light. That's called advertising. And we all sort of understand that the actual experience of visiting a place is not going to match up with the marketing, the same way that a Spider-Man ice cream treat isn't going to look the way it does on the wrapper. And at the risk of derailing this entire video, I would like to tell what I consider to be a very funny story about Martin Heidegger. Heidegger was one of the most influential philosophers of the 20th century. You want to know how important he was? He was the second person mentioned in Monty Python's Philosopher's Song.
Heidegger, Heidegger was a boozy beggar who could think you under the table.
His 1927 book, Being and Time, introduced the concept of Dasein, a radical redefinition of existence itself. And all you have to do is skim the first few pages to understand that Heidegger is obsessed with the ancient Greeks. The more ancient, the better, actually. He thought that starting with Plato, it all went downhill. Anyway, I'm not exactly sure what Heidegger was up to between 1933 and 1945, but I'm sure it wasn't anything shameful. Let's skip ahead to 1962, when the 73-year-old philosopher decided, finally, to visit Greece for the first time. Heidegger had this fantasy of Greece built up in his mind. Before he visited the Temple of Delphi, he wrote, "I was suspecting that this, which had been considered as the crowning visit of the entire journey, would surpass all knowledge and imagination carried with me, and would speak with its own language." Totally reasonable expectations. No possibility of disappointment there. And this is a great time to mention another German concept, Schadenfreude.
It's German for happiness with the misfortune of others.
Happiness of the misfortune of others. That is German.
Because Heidegger could not stop complaining about what a tourist trap Delphi was. During the hours we stayed at the holy place, the crowd of visitors increased significantly. Everywhere, people taking pictures. They throw their memories in the technically produced picture. They abandon, without clue, the feast of thinking that they ignore. He complained about the crowds for pages and pages. And it's hard to believe this whiner managed to hook up with a badass like Hannah Arendt. Now, why do I bring this up? Because Martin Heidegger's experience is something that influencers on TikTok know all about. Everybody wants a magical tourism experience. The problem is that everybody wants a magical tourism experience. So although you might crave something from those 2006 postcards, what you're going to get is a lot closer to the crowded, tacky, chaotic atmosphere of Zari. Here's the interesting thing, though. I don't think Marina made this video to show what a terrible tourist trap Athens really is. I think she genuinely likes this crowded, tacky, chaotic atmosphere. She even likes the creepy off-brand Mickey Mouse. She's not showing us the bad side of Greece. She's showing us the Greece she loves. Here's what she told WeWee Blogs back in February.
People know these stereotypes about Greece, you know, the beautiful islands, the sea, the ancient monuments, the Greek salad, the feta. My dream would be to bring out like the new Greece of today, the urban culture, obviously, because, you know, we all grew up in the city.
So let's do a little tourism theory. In 1990, British sociologist John Urry published The Tourist Gaze. If you're familiar with the concept of the male gaze from film theory, you can probably guess that the tourist gaze was not a good thing. In this book, the tourists are generally rich and Western, and they reduce the locals to objects of study and props for photographs. Urry explained, "In much tourism, there is the equivalent of looking at the mad behind bars. The gaze of many tourists involves an obvious intrusion into people's lives." But in 2005, Daria Mayos published a paper on what she called the mutual gaze. Everybody gazes at everybody. This article argues that host and guest are both the mad who stand behind bars that separate them sharply and both gaze at each other. As opposed to views that see tourists as rational, independent, and powerful actors, this article suggests that they are targets of manipulation, staging, and the gaze of the host population as they operate in a strange place and are very visible to the inhabitants in their enclaves. I think the mutual gaze is a good framework for understanding this music video. Marina is playing the role of a tour guide, so in a way, she's working for the tourist, trying to earn his approval. In scenes like the one in the restaurant, it seems like the Greeks are reduced to stereotypes, dancing around the table. This scene has the text, "travel vlog" in the upper left corner, so we can imagine them performing for the camera, knowing their livelihood depends on giving people what they expect. But wait, they aren't the only stereotypes. Look at this tourist in the blue shirt. He's got two cameras, he's got socks with sandals, he's staring at postcards and random fountains. He's playing a role too, the role of tourist. The key scene in the video is when the song grinds to a halt while Marina does donuts in her taxi with her passenger looking like a deer in the headlights. This is a moment when the tourist is 100% not in control. If anyone is gazing, it's her. Now, remember that German word, Schadenfreude? Well, it's relevant here because this tourist is very German-coded. The actor is not actually German. He's a retired American who has been Marina's fan since way back in 2016. But a number of Greeks have assured us that this guy looks like a German tourist. Maybe something about the socks and the sandals combo? Anyway, Greeks are still a little sore at Germany for driving a hard bargain during the 2008 debt crisis. So giving this guy the Fast and the Furious treatment in a taxi is a little bit of revenge. But we think this isn't really about establishing dominance. We know from our previous videos that these donuts are meant to represent something important to Marina, something fundamental about the way she experiences the world. So doing donuts with the tourist is symbolic of showing him the real Greece, the modern Greece, she said in interviews that nobody gets to see. And check out these happy snapshots from the very end of the video. It doesn't seem like the donuts traumatized Blue Shirt too much. He's grinning from ear to ear with his arm around Marina. To quote the tourist gaze, tourists do not only decode past texts, but are part of creating new ones through ongoing interactions and performances with other tourists, guides, discourses, buildings, and objects. Greece is a country dependent on tourism, and the Greeks are not above performing for the tourist gaze. But that doesn't necessarily mean they're always being exploited. The tourist seems lost and confused until Marina takes him for a ride. It's a mutually beneficial arrangement, and the propulsive energy in the video comes from the push and pull between tourists and locals. He doesn't end up seeing what he came to Greece to see. Instead, he sees Marina's new Greece, which is what her video is revealing to the whole world. Finally, let's say a few words about the lyrics. On the surface, it seems like they could be about an on-again, off-again lover. We've heard Marina talk about scents before, but not referring to a man.
All this culture that we have that goes back in centuries, and it almost smells like all the generations of people that have existed before us.
So maybe the song is about Greece itself. The uncertainty of rolling the dice is something all Greeks feel after a generation of economic pain. But like any gambler, Greece has reason to be hopeful about the future. Marina's willingness to roll the dice and embrace the outcome seems like another form of putting on makeup while doing donuts. Life can be chaotic, like a song made up of 10 songs mashed together, or a movie made up of 10 plot lines mashed together. But just like she did with Montiza back in 2017, she's harnessing the power of the urban environment and making it her own. Because Greece is not only statues from the past. Greece, actually, is all around. We'll see you next time. I think I speak for all of us when I say the Blue Shirt tourist needs to be on stage at Eurovision, taking pictures of the audience.